Pentecostal prayers, if you have this book, page 154. Now, the English translation is on page 155. This is from the Vishvasara Tantra. Om Brahmanandam Paramasukhadam Kevalam Jnanamurtim Dvandvatitam Gagana Sadrisham Tattvamasya Dilakshyam Ekam Nityam Vimalamachalam Sarvadi Sakshibhutam Bhavatitam Trigunarahitam Sadgurum Tam Namami Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. I offer my humble salutations to the Guru, who is the embodiment of the bliss of Brahman, the giver of the greatest beatitude, the personification of the highest knowledge, who is beyond the pairs of opposites like pleasure and pain, and untouched by evil like the sky, whom thou art that, and similar scriptural passages have in view, the one without a second, the eternal, the pure, the immovable, the witness of all mental modifications, abiding ever beyond thoughts and attributes. To Divine Guru, I offer my salutations. Om peace. May there be peace in our hearts, peace and joy in our hearts. May there be peace and harmony amongst all beings. And may there be peace everywhere in nature. So we'll continue from verse number 41 onwards. The next four verses, they describe the attitude of those people who do not have a very strong sense of viveka. Viveka means the discrimination between real and the unreal. Brahman alone is real. You can say, instead of Brahman, we can use God. There is no harm. God alone is real. And everything else, universe, is only illusory in the sense it exists, it is not, it's not absent, but it's not permanent, it is always changing, and it is not real. It is not absolutely real. Relatively real, empirical relative reality is there. We have to deal with it. That discrimination that God alone is real and God is the only goal of life, not worldly accomplishments or enjoyments. Many people don't have that kind of understanding. They are more interested in pursuing the worldly pursuits. Such people, their attitude is described in the next four verses. We can go through them fairly rapidly. So let me chant verse number 41. Vyavasayatmika buddhi ekeh kuru nandana bahushakha kyanantascha buddhayo vyavasayanam vyavasayatmika buddhi ekeh kuru nandana bahushakha kyanantascha buddhayo vyavasayanam. The translation here is the conviction regarding the twofold yoga, karma and jnana, marked by resolution, is single. The convictions of the irresolute are indeed many branched and endless, O Arjuna. The translation is not always very clear. It's a literal translation. It gives a general meaning, but we have to understand the intended true meaning of the verse. Vyavasayatmika buddhi. That means the thinking. Buddhi means intellect or way of thinking. Of those people who or very clear, who have very clear one-pointed conviction regarding the goal of spiritual illumination. For many people, the goal of life is moksha, liberation, salvation, spiritual illumination, God realization, in whatever way we want to put it. Jivan Mukti, that's the goal of life for seekers. But for many people, that is not the goal. For many people, worldly enjoyments, worldly success, those are more important. So the first category of people in the first line, Sri Krishna says, O Arjuna, the conviction of those people whose goal is spiritual illumination is one-pointed. Their whole life is directed towards one goal, namely God realization. Other things they will do as much as necessary. They're not running away from life. They stay in their household or wherever they are placed, do their duties to the family, to the society, to the employer, to the country, everything. But their goal is always towards God realization. Such people are rare. Yavasayatmika buddhi eka. Their conviction is one-pointed. One-pointed means goal is very clear. God realization is my goal. Other things, such as the daily duties, that I will do as much as necessary. But my goal in this life is to realize God. Such people are one category of people. As opposed to them, there is another category of people, second group of people, who are Bahushakha Anantasya Buddhayo Avyavasayanam. Avyavasayana means whose minds are scattered in many, many different directions. In the first category, the mind is one-pointed. Only goal is God realization. This always, they keep that in mind constantly. Other things, as much as necessary, they will do. They will not do anything to hurt or damage that achievement of that goal. As opposed to that, avyavasayinam buddhihi. Those people whose minds are not well properly cultivated, whose minds are scattered in many different directions, bahushakha anantashtu. In many different branches, their mind is scattered. They'll think about food, they'll think about entertainment, they'll think about dress and car and children, grandchildren, and success and fame, acquisition of wealth, money, all these things. They're concerned about many things. Whereas the other people, they're concerned about only one thing, God realization. One-pointed conviction towards one goal, scattered mind divided into many different branches, thinking about many different things. So two categories of people are there. Then the next three verses, 42, 43, 44, those three verses describe the first category of people. We are not very much interested to know details of how they think. It's not important to us because we belong to the second category. Second category means people who want to realize only God. We are interested in the world as much as is necessary, as much as is possible, to the extent necessary, but our main interest in life is God realization. So we'll do that. Verse number 42. Yamimam pushpitam vacham pravadantya vipaschitah vedavadaratah partha nanyadastiti vadinah yamimam pushpitam vacham pravadantya vipaschitah vedavadaratah Partha Nanyadastiti Vadinaha. They are the unwise people who speak flowery language, or Arjuna. They take delight in the letter of the Vedas, in literal interpretation of the Vedas, and declare there is nothing else. Nanyadastiti, there is nothing else. Except what? In the commentary, Shankaracharya says, Swarga Pashu Adishu. their interest is to acquire wealth and enjoy the wealth here. Pashu means cattle. Those days, the indicator of wealth was cattle. How many heads of cattle a person had indicated how wealthy he was. Very poor people had one or two cows, and some were making a living out of that. And rich people used to have hundreds of cows. So the number of cows a person had, cattle, was how a person's wealth was determined. Nowadays, it is the indicator of wealth is dollars. How many dollars a person has? So, swarga pashuva adishu. They want to enjoy in this world wealth. Pashu means cattle. Cattle means wealth, and whatever money can buy comfort and enjoyment and pleasure and everything. And they also want to go to heaven after finishing life in this world. Now, that was their view. Enjoy, continue to enjoy greater pleasures in heaven, which are not available on this earth. More enjoyment. And when the stock of punya is exhausted, they will go come back to the human birth. Again, they take birth. Again, the same story. Again, they enjoy here wealth and progeny and all those things, position, power, fame, comfort, and then again they do good deeds and go to heaven. That is how they think the goal of life is, to go to heaven. Enjoy here and enjoy there in heaven also. But as we shall see in the 9th chapter, heaven is not the goal of life. For true spiritual seekers, heaven is not the goal of life. Liberation, God is the goal of life. Once you reach God, then you don't have to come back to the cycle of birth and death. It is a one-time achievement. Once you realize God, once you realize our true nature as Brahman, then we will not come back into the realm of ignorance, into will not enter back into the cycle of birth and death, transmigratory cycle of birth and death. That is, once for all, we are free. Freedom once for all. That is moksha or liberation. But these people, they want to go to heaven. Heaven is not a permanent thing. It's a temporary. Like life on earth is temporary, life in heaven is also temporary. How long can a person live in heaven depends upon how many good deeds he has done. Kamya karma, worshipping God with the seeking heavenly benefit, going to heaven. Like that, there are some kamya karma they will do. And they go to heaven and they enjoy there for some time, as long as the punya, good deeds they have done, lasts. And when that is exhausted, they'll come back to earthly life again. That is not the real goal of life. In the 9th chapter, Sri Krishna says, Kshine punye martyalokam vishanti. Punya means the good deeds we do in this life, kamya karma we do in this life, seeking benefit. Kshine punye, when that benefit of the good deeds we have done, punya we have accumulated, kshine, when it is exhausted, what happens to them? Martyalokam vishanti, they will come back to the human world, this world. So that is not the goal of life. So going to heaven is a temporary thing. Sometimes I give this example of the very temporary nature of heavenly enjoyment by giving this example of a vacation cruise. If you want to go on a cruise, how long the cruise will be depends upon how much money you can spend. If you give maybe a couple of $1,000, we'll go to a 3-day cruise to the Caribbean. And in the cruise, when you go on a ship, a cruise ship, there's only enjoyment. You don't have, there is no work. You don't have to go to office or anything. Forget about work. Only enjoyment. Lot of food is available. All kinds of ethnic food. South Indian food, idli, sambar, North Indian food, everything. Everything is available. Ethnic food, Korean food, Chinese food, Thai food, everything is available. Round the clock. Food court is open. And there is all kind of entertainment. There is magic show, circus, and tennis court, swimming pool, parties, and all kinds of things out there. You can enjoy all as much as you want. How long? As long as the money lasts. If you pay only $3,000, it's 3-day cruise or maybe 5 days. But if you want to go on a longer cruise, 3 weeks cruise to Europe and all those countries, then you have to pay more, $10,000 or more. Then there'll be more enjoyment. They will stop at every port, give you time to go to the shopping center, buy things in the shopping centers and memorabilia, all those drinks, and enjoy all kinds of food and parties and dancing and music and everything. Then what happens? When the money is exhausted, you will come be brought back to the port from where you embark, and your cruise is over. Please get off the ship. Next part, next group of travelers is ready to board. Swarga is like that. If you do a little bit of punya, you will stay in Swarga for some time. But a lot of punya, you will stay in Swarga for a long time. But no matter how long a time you stay in Swarga, once the punya is exhausted, you'll be brought back to the human world, and again you start from square one. Infancy, childhood, and kaumaranya, mananjara, all those things you have seen, the whole story repeats again. That is not the goal of life. The goal of life is God realization or self-knowledge, atma-jnana, brahma-jnana. Once you know we are the divine being, we are not human beings, the body cements we thought we were. When that knowledge is gained and experienced, then there is no coming back to the human world again. You will become one with Brahman. You will become Brahman. Just like a river becomes ocean when it merges into the ocean, then it is forever, it is one with the ocean. Ocean is infinite. River is finite. So when the Jivatma merges in Paramatma, everything becomes Paramatma, only remains. Jivatma merges into Paramatma. And there is no limitation of a single individual being. So that is the goal of life. So the Vedavadirataha, those people who interpret the vakya, the sentences of the Vedas in literal way, nanyadasti, there is nothing else, iti vadita, vadinaha. They think there is nothing else. Only thing is to enjoy in this life, in this world, and enjoy in the heaven also. That's all there is to me. There is to life. Yamimam pushpita macham prabadanti. Those people speak very flowery language, fluently they interpret the Vedas in a literal way, and their goal is very limited, only to go to heaven. Abhipaschitaha, such people are called, Abhipaschita means, Shankara translates, Abhipaschita is alpamedhaha, avivekinaha, people with limited intellect. Medhas means intellectual power. Alpamedhaha, avivekinaha, don't have the distinction between real, which is God or Brahman, and unreal, which is this world. They don't have the clear distinction. So we are not interested in what they think. Then the same theme continues in 43 also. 43. Kamatmana svargapara janma karma phala pradam kriya vishesha bahulam bhogaishvarya gatim prati kamatmana svargapara janma karma phala pradam kriya vishesha bahulam bhogaishvarya gatim prati. Kamatmana means those people who are full of desire for enjoyment here and in the swarga hereafter also. Enjoyment is the goal. Kamatmanaha. Swarga para, their goal is to go to swarga, to heaven. Janma karma phala pradam. This kind of life, doing karma, going to swarga, perpetuates the cycle of birth and janma. We take birth, karma, we perform the rituals and duties. Phala pradam, the phalam, the fruit of that we enjoy in the heaven. Kriya vishesh bahulam, they are engaged in very many specific different kinds of rites, yajnas, all those things. Bhogaishwarya gatim prati, to get enjoyment, wealth, progeny, children, grandchildren, and money, etc. Fame, position, power. Their interest is not God realization. Their interest is enjoyment here and in the next world also. Then the continuation. Until we finish 44, this all description of that one category of people. We are not that much keenly interested in that one. 44. Bhogaishwarya prasak तानां तया पुहृत चेतसां व्यवसायात्मिका बुद्धिः समाधौ न विधीयते भोगैश्वर्य प्रसक्तानां तया पुहृत चेतसां व्यवसायात्मिका बुद्धिः समाधौ न विधीयते. In the case of those who have given themselves up to pleasures and power and whose minds have been enslaved by the words of the Vedas, the Veda here means the Karma Kanda, not the Upanishads. That command writes, where the description of yajnas are described, are given, there is no chance of the resolute mind addressing itself to concentration. Such people's minds are scattered and occupied with only one question, how to find enjoyment. In this life here and when we die, when you go to heaven, how to find enjoyment there. That's the only thing they are interested in. Bhogaishwarya prasaktanam means engaged in getting pleasure, wealth with their viveka stolen away. Apaharta chetasam. Apahara means to take away. Chetas means buddhi, thinking power. Their thinking power is stolen away by the desire for pleasures. When you have so many desires in the mind, the desires will do not allow us to think in the right direction. They only take us in the direction of the how to get happiness, how to get pleasure, how to make more money, how to enjoy. That's what they are always thinking. Their mind, scattered mind, cannot become absorbed in samadhi. Samadhi means concentration. They cannot concentrate on God. Their attention is scattered among numerous sense pleasures. So these are one category of people. Now that topic ends there. We don't have to worry too much about the previous 3-4 verses. Next verse is very important, 45. This talks about the Triguna. This is a very important verse. You have to study it carefully in detail. 45. त्रैगुण्य विषया वेदा निस्त्रैगुण्यो भवार्जुन निर्द्वन्द्वो नित्यसत्त्वस्थो निर्योगक्षेम आत्मवान. वर्स नंबर 45. त्रैगुण्य विषया वेदा निस्त्रैगुण्यो भवार्जुन निर्द्वन्द्वो नित्यसत्त्वस्थो Niryagakshema Atmavan. In this verse, Sri Krishna gives very important instructions that we have to follow. Very important verse. Veda means the scriptures. Veda means not only the what we call Veda, but other scriptures also can be included in this context only. They talk about everything qualified by the three gunas, Trigunya Vishaya Veda. Trigunas are sattva, rajas and tamas. We have heard about these trigunas, sattva, rajas and tamas. We'll study these trigunas in most detail in the 14th chapter. Also 17, 18 chapters, they will come back again. So for now, everything described in the Vedas is qualified by the trigunas, sattva, rajas and tamas. Qualified means they are actually the constituents of everything that exists in the creation. Three gunas are the basic constituents of everything, according to one school of philosophy. Sri Ramakrishna explains the nature of the three gunas. You are using a very nice parable. What is sattva guna? What does it do? Why we should pursue sattva guna, become more sattvic? What is rajo guna? What does it do? And how to handle rajas? What does it cause? What rajoguna causes in our life? How it manifests in our life? What is tamoguna? What is tamas and why we should avoid it? These things we have to understand. To understand these three things, the nature of the three gunas, Sri Ramakrishna gives a parable. You all most probably have heard of this parable. There was a merchant who used to sell his wares in the market and go back home with the money. Sales proceeds every evening. One evening, he took a shortcut through the woods. instead of going on the highway, he goes to the woods. In the woods, there are three robbers come and attack him. The three robbers are of different natures. They attack him and they take away all his property, whatever money he had, his Rolex watch and gold ring and necklace, whatever he was wearing, merchant. He takes, they take everything, and then they decide and discuss among themselves what to do with this guy. One person says, we should kill this man. If we leave him alone, alive, he will go back to the town and call the police and describe to the police as they will come after us. So we should not let him go alive. We should kill him. One person says that one. The second robber says, no, no, why we should kill this man? Poor guy, let him go home. But we should tie him with a rope to a tree so he will not escape. In the meantime, a tiger may come and kill him and we don't have to kill him. Or by the time he somehow struggles and becomes faint, goes home, we'll be far away from this place. So we don't have to kill him. Let us tie him to a tree. Second robber suggests. Third robber says, no, no, why we should tie him to a tree? We should leave him alone. Because the time he walks out to this home, to the town or village where he lives, we will be far away from here. We don't have to kill him or tie him. We have taken everything from him. Poor guy, let him go. Why to kill him or tie him? Third robber says. So some discussion takes place among the three robbers. Finally, they follow the suggestion of the middle, second robber. They tie him to a tree and then run away with all his property, whatever he had, money, everything that he had. After some time, what happened? This man is tied to a tree. He cannot escape. And it's becoming dark and he cannot go home. He's suffering. The third robber comes. The third robber suggested that we should let him go home free. He comes back somehow, leaving the other two robbers, they go away. The third robber comes back and unties the knots, makes him free and shows him the way to his village, because he was lost in the woods. So he tells the third robber tells the merchant, go in this way, go in this way, this much distance, you will find your village and then you will be safe. Then the merchant becomes very grateful, very thankful to the third robber who came back and released him from the ties, from the bondage, and shows him the way to freedom. So the merchant invites the third robber to his home. Please come to my home and I want to give you some reward. I want to entertain you. You have saved my life and you came and untied me and showed me the way to freedom. So I'm very grateful to you. Please come to my home. Merchant invites the third robber. Third robber says, no, I cannot come. I'm still a robber. If I come to the town, the police are looking for me. They have my fingerprint. They will catch me. So I cannot come. You go home and I will go back to my own place. Join the other robbers. So in this parable, the man goes home. In this parable, the three robbers represent the three gunas. The first robber who wanted to kill the person, he represents tamas. Tamasic qualities are anger, violence, lust, uncontrollable greed, tendency to perform illegal, immoral actions. These are all tamasic tendencies. If you engage in those actions, life will be ruined. The second robber who wanted to tie the merchant, he represents rajas. Rajas ties us to the world with the strong power of attachment. Rajas causes attachment to sense objects and to people, to places, to whatever we have, we become attached to that one. So attachment is the problem with the Rajoguna, second robber, who wanted to tie him. The third robber who shows him the way, frees him from the bondage, and shows him the way to freedom, he represents Sattvaguna. Sattvaguna frees us from all impurities, from all bondages, all limitations, and shows us the way to freedom. Freedom means freedom from the world of birth and death, transmigration, from the world of cycle of transmigration. Freedom is moksha, liberation, shows us the way to liberation. Sattva shows the way to liberation. Rajas binds and keeps us attached to the world. Tamas kills and ruins our life. So these are the three gunas. So the message is very clear. Which guna we should pursue? We should pursue Sattva guna. But Satvaguna, while it is the best of the three gunas, it has a limitation. It is given to, for activity, we need Rajas also. So Rajas is necessary. As long as it is combined with Sattva, it is pure. It is creative energy, gives us energy to work. Rajas is needed for energy to work. And if you combine Rajas and Sattva, our life will be successful and will culminate in liberation, freedom. So tamas, if you pursue, our life will be ruined. So these are the three gunas. Raigunya Vishaya Veda, Istraigunya Bhava Arjuna. To Arjuna, Sri Krishna, to all of us, Sri Krishna says, everything in this world is bound by the three gunas, qualified by the three gunas, but you become free from the three gunas. Istraigunya Bhava means free from the three gunas, you become. You become free from even Sattva also, you have to give. We'll understand why Sattva also has to be given up. First, you have to give up tamas. Tamas means anger, violence, hatred, tendency to do immoral, illegal actions, steal and cheat, and violent actions. Those are all indicators of tamasic guna. That we have to give up entirely. But Rajas is necessary. Rajas provides the energy, creativity. To some extent, Rajas is necessary. Rajas combined with Sattva is very good, creative energy. Rajas combined with Tamas is destructive energy. If energy to do activity is combined with impurities of the mind, such as anger, greed, etc., pride, jealousy, etc., then it will be destructive, destroys the person. So Rajas is in between. It is necessary only when in combination with Sattva. In combination with Tamas, Rajas can be deadly. So Rajas is necessary, but with a qualification. Rajas must be combined with Sattva, then it is conducive to success and peace and joy and eventually to liberation. Sattva we have to become. Pure Sattva we have to become. So on the second line, he gives three instructions. These three instructions are very important. Second line of verse number 45. Here, first of all, he says, in the first line, Istraigunya Bhava, become free from the three gunas. That's the ultimate step. Becoming free from Tamas is the first step. Keeping Rajas with combination with Sattva is the second step. Giving up Sattva is the third and final step. When Sattva is given up, then we become one with the divine. Now, be free from all the three qualities, then we become Nistraigunya, free from three gunas, then we become one with the divine. That's the ultimate step. But before we reach that ultimate step, we have to give. First step is to give up tamas. Second step is keep rajas and combine it with sattva. That is where we are right now. We have to give up tamas, have some rajas because it gives the energy to activity, and then combine it with sattva with all good qualities. Sattva means all good qualities. So like ahimsa, non-violence, sattva is non-violence. Tamas is violence. Sattva is non-violence. Ahimsa, satyam. Sattva means telling the truth. Rajas can be in between also. Sometimes it's a white lie, some people will say. That is also not good. Sri Ramakrishna says, even those who are engaged in business must be always truthful. Even that means loss in business, truth should not be sacrificed. That is the highest ideal. Always adhering to truth under all circumstances, no matter what the consequences are. That is the highest ideal. So Rajas is necessary. Tamas should be given up. Sattva has to be cultivated more and more. So that is first instruction. Eventually, in the final step, giving up all the three gunas, then we are no longer human beings. We are human beings as long as we are three gunas. So some of the three gunas are there. That's why we are in this state of human, as a human being. But when you become totally divine, no gunas are there. Only God is not qualified with the three gunas. Everything else in this creation is qualified with three gunas. When you become, then we are completely, totally, permanently free from all the three gunas. Just in Istraigunya Bhava. But before that, three things have to be done, which are doable. First is Nirdvandva Bhava. Dvandva means what? Dvandva means pairs of opposites. What is Dvandva? Dvandva means happiness, unhappiness, pleasure, pain, gain and loss, fame, infamy. These are all perceivable. We oscillate between these two. In our life, we have some pleasure, we have some pain. Sometimes we succeed, sometimes we fail. Sometimes we gain, sometimes we lose. So we are oscillating between this extreme and that extreme. But here is Sri Krishna says, Nirdvandva Bhava, free from all dualities, free from pain and pleasure, don't be affected by success and failure, remain equanimous in success and failure, and remain calm in gain and loss. Whether you lose or you gain, you remain calm, don't be affected by gain and loss, don't be affected by the dualities. Where did we study that one? Remain unperturbed under all circumstances, in pain and pleasure, gain and loss, fame, infamy, success and failure. We studied that in verse number 38. Verse number 38 in the second chapter was very important verse. This is follow-up of that verse. 45 is follow-up of 38. Second line. There in verse number 38, Sri Krishna said, Sukha dukhe same kritva labha labho jaya jayau tato yuddhaya yujyasva naivam papamavapsyasi. The first line of 38, that is a precursor, precedent to the second line of 45. There what Sri Krishna said, in remain sama, same kratva, considering equally, remaining equanimous in sukha dukkha. Labha alabha. Labha means gain, profit. Alabha means loss. In gain and loss, jaya ajayo. Jaya means success, ajaya means absence, or opposite of success, failure. In all those conditions, whatever life brings, good or bad, success or failure, you remain calm, considering everything equally and taking everything in stride. Don't be affected by success and failure, because today what is success can bring failure tomorrow. Today what is fame can become infamy tomorrow. Nothing is permanent, nothing is stable. Therefore, you become free from their sway, from their influence. You remain calm under all circumstances. That was 38. Same thing, Nirdvandva Bhava means same thing. Remain unaffected by the Dvandva. Dvandva means duality, pairs of opposites, Sukha Dukkha, etc. First instruction. Every day we get opportunity. Almost every day we get opportunity to practice Nirdvandva. Some people, sometimes you are happy, sometimes some good thing happens. Same day evening, something unpleasant happens, you become unhappy. So when happiness comes, we should not rejoice too much, exult too much. When unhappiness comes, we should not become too much depressed or sorrowful or anger or frustrated. We take everything calmly in stride. Nirdvandva Bhava, very important instruction. And this comes again and again in later chapters also. Second instruction, nitya sattvastaha, always established in sattva. Sattva means purity, truthfulness, non-violence, calmness, absence of jealousy and pride. Absence of jealousy, pride and fear. All of these are enemies of people. So becoming free from all of these impurities is becoming sattvic. Sattvic person means a calm person, a nice person who remains unperturbed in all circumstances, who is always kind, who is always compassionate, who is always loving, always serving other people. Such a person is called a sattvic person. So sattvas, nitya sattvastha means always established in sattva. Very important instruction. Then third instruction, in second line is niryoga kshema. Oh, four instructions are there, not three. Niryoga kshema bhava. Yoga means what? Kshema means what? Use your yoga kshema. Yoga means acquisition of things that we don't have, necessary things. In the commentary, Shankara describes yoga as anupatasya upadanam yoga. Anupata means something that is absent, that is necessary. Unnecessary things we should not acquire. Something is necessary. For example, we need food. And if there is no food, we should acquire food. We should strive, get some job, work hard. To honest means we have to make money and buy food. That is necessary. So that is anupatam is something that is necessary but absent. Anupatasya upadanam. Upadanam means acquiring things which are necessary for human life. Daily life, we should acquire things. Renunciation does not mean not acquiring necessary things. Even swamis also have to have some food and some clothing to wear. These are necessities. These are acquiring necessary things are called yoga. Yoga means combining, union, and acquiring things necessary for daily life. It's called yoga. Too much worry about it is not necessary. Whatever comes, we'll accept and be happy with that one. Kshema. Kshema means upatasya rakshanam kshemaha, Shankara says. Whatever has been earned, upatta means whatever has been acquired or earned, tasya rakshanam, protection of what we have. Whatever we have to protect it carefully. We should not squander away the things we have. We should protect carefully whatever property, money, clothing, food we have, body we have. We have to protect it nicely, carefully, because everything has a purpose in human life. So yogakshema means too much concerned about yogakshema. To the extent necessary, you acquire things. More than necessity, we should not, then become acquiring becomes greed. Need to be fulfilled, greed to be rejected. I'm not going to be greedy, but I will provide what is, I'll acquire what is necessary for life. Too much concern about acquiring things, too much acquisition of wealth and so many cars and so many dresses and so many properties. Some people have 4 or 5 houses, one in Florida, one in Bangalore, one in Calcutta, one in Pennsylvania. It's not necessary. You could only stay in one place at a time. No matter how many houses you have, you can only stay in one house in one room at a time. You don't need more than that. So too much concern about acquiring things is not good. Too much worry about protection is also not good. Nidyogokshema Atmavan. Atmavan means, here the definition of Atmavan in the commentary is, Atmavan apramattaha. We know the word pramada from previous studies. Apramatta is a past participle, description of a person who does not have pramada. Pramada means what? Forgetfulness. Forgetting who we are, where we are, what your duty is, what is right, what is wrong. Forgetting essential things is pramada. The pramada has come in it's a very important topic in Mahabharata also. There is a conversation between Sanat Kumar and Dhritarashtra in the Mahabharata where they talk about pramada. We will not go into that details that much now. Pramada means forgetfulness of what is right, what is wrong, what is important, what is not important. Forgetfulness of our duty, forgetfulness of who we are. When the anger comes, we have pramada. We forget everything. We behave in a very unruly manner, irrational manner under the influence of anger, which you would not ordinarily do when you are not angry. In our saner moments, we don't do things like that. We are not ordinarily decent human beings. We like to be that way. But when anger catches hold of us, we become pramatta. We forget everything, what is right, what is wrong, what to say, what not to say. All those things are forgotten. We become pramatta means one who has forgotten what is to be remembered. Apramatta bhava, Atmavan means, don't forget you are the Atman. The most important thing to remember is, you are the Atman. That's what the Upanishad Mahavakya says. You are that, tattvamasi, you are that. That we should never forget. Forgetting that and thinking I am the body, I am the mind is the biggest pramada. The biggest mistake that one can do is to forget our true divine nature and to assume this erroneous identification as the body and the mind. That's the biggest pramada we all are prone to do. Apramatta means one who never forgets his true nature, always remembers God is within me. People like us, devotees who don't want to be jnanis, I am Brahmasmi, is difficult for me. But people like us, you can always remember God is present within me, within everybody else. Sarvasya chaham hridi sannivishtaha. I am present in the hearts of all. Chapter 15, verse 15. 15, 15, easy to remember. Sarvasya hridi aham sannivishtaha. Bhagavan is saying. I am present in all. That we should never forget. That one thing is easy to remember. Whether I think I am the body or Brahman is difficult. But it's easy to remember God is present in me always. That pramada should, forgetfulness should never be allowed to happen. I always remember that God is present within me. What is the implication of that? What if God is present within me? Then whatever I think, whatever I say, whatever I do, He is watching from within me. He is a sakshi, He is an eternal witness. Every thought that I think, I may be able to hide my thoughts from you. I may be thinking bad thoughts and I may be saying very nice words. But I can't do that with the God. He is present within me. He knows what I am thinking. So remembering that He is watching me keeps me on the right track. Always remembering God is present within me. Always, for jnanis, always remembering that I am Brahman, I am not the body and the mind. Mano buddhi ahankara chetaninaham and koham, in that case, Chidanandarupa Shivaham Shivam. That always remembering that I am Chidanandarupa Shiva, I am the Atman, I am the Brahman, I am not the body mind. That is for jnanis. For bhaktas, something to be always remembered, never be forgotten, is presence of God in me and in everybody else, in everything else also. Not only in human beings, animals, plants, inanimate objects, He is present. So that should govern all my actions. Even if I handle a glass of water, in that also He is present. So I should keep it gently, nicely in its proper place and wash it clean, nicely after use. Presence of God. The constant recollection of God's presence in all and everything, including oneself, should always govern all our actions and thoughts and speech. I should not speak something nice, keeping something evil in my mind. Then He is watching that one from within me. Is what is present in my heart. Sarvasaradi aham sannivishtha. 15:15. So many other shlokas in the Bhagavad Gita where the same theme comes. God is present in all. But we should remember constantly. We will never forget God's presence between us. That is Atmavan. Fourth instruction is Apramatta Bhava. Always never forget the presence of God. Never forget that you are Atman, you are Brahman. Always remember that ultimate final truth, that we are that ultimate reality. So the four instructions are given in a second line. This second line is very important. Here, the 45, verse number 45, second line. Nirdvandvo nityasatvastho niryagakshema atmavan. Become free from the pairs of opposites. Always remain established in sattva, nityasatvastha. Always remaining established in sattva. Don't give room for tamas. Some degree of rajas is necessary. Combine with sattva, it is good. Niryagakshema, don't worry too much about acquiring things and whatever comes by the will of God, grace of God, accept you, that would that be happy. Describing the qualities of a bhakta devotee in a 12th chapter, Sri Krishna says, whatever is available with that devotee's content. Santushto yena kena chit. Antushto yena kena chit means with whatever is available without resorting to too much effort and illegal ways of acquiring things, whatever comes due to our karma, due to our effort, with that we should remain happy. In the Bhajagovinda Stotram, Shankaracharya says, Yallabhasene jakarmopattam vittam chena vinodaya chittam. How much money to earn? How much money do we need? There's answered in this, by Shankara in this verse. Nijakarma upatam, earned by one's own karma. Upadana means earning, acquiring, adding things. By nijakarma, by our own effort, honest, dharmic effort. Nijakarma upatam, yadvittam labase, whatever money you gain, tena chittam inade, be happy with that one. Don't be greedy for money. Whatever is earned, gained by honest, hard work, with that be satisfied. With this, much or less is not important. Satisfaction and tripti is very important. Yallabhasainaja karma patam vittam tena vinodaya chittam. With that be happy. That's it. That is niyoga kshema. Fourth instruction is atmavan. Atmavan is apramattava, means never forget that God is present within you. Never forget you are that ultimate reality, Brahman. Keeping all these four things in mind, we have to lead our life. So verse number 45, important verse. Then we have that. 46 is easy. Then we come across two of the most important shlokas in the whole of Bhagavad Gita. 47, 48. Before that, we do 46 quickly. 46. Yavanartha udapane sarvata samplutodake tavan sarveshu vedeshu brahmanasya vijanatah. 46. Yavanartha udapane sarvata samplutodake tavan sarveshu vedeshu brahmanasya vijanatah. For a knower of Brahman, vijanatah brahmana, for a knower of Brahman who has realized the ultimate truth, vijanatah, one who knows the truth, for such a person there is as much profit from all the Vedas as there is profit from reservoirs when all around there is inundation. To give a simpler example, supposing we have a huge lake, like Michigan, big lake, and that is very near to us, and we can get plenty of water, as much as water as we want, good clean water we get. Lake is available to us within a few feet. And next to that, there is a puddle created by cattle when they walk in rainy season. In that puddle, some muddy water has accumulated. Which will you prefer? Will you prefer the puddle with containing 1 ounce of 2 ounces of muddy water, or you prefer the Lake Michigan? If you have Lake Michigan, then you don't care for the puddle of water. In the same way, when you have knowledge of Brahman, you don't care for the Vedas. Vedas are scriptures. Scriptures are necessary only to understand what is the goal of life and how to reach that goal. Once that goal is reached, then you don't need scriptures anymore. Sri Ramakrishna gives this example. Supposing a person is crossing a river using a boat, a small boat, a canoe or something, and when the river is crossed, then what do you do with the boat? You don't carry it with you. You just leave it there at the river bank and proceed to wherever you have to go. So Vedas or scriptures have a limited purpose. Once the goal of the Vedas is reached, then you don't need them anymore. And just like we don't need a small puddle of water when we have a huge lake available to us. Sarvata samplutodake, surrounded by water, clean water, udapane yavanartha, as much benefit as we have from udapana, means a small reservoir of water. We don't need that anymore. We have access to plenty of clean water, unlimited quantity of clean water. So when we have reached the goal of God realization, then we don't need the Vedas anymore. They have served their purpose. When you prepare the dish, then recipe book is no longer necessary. You keep the recipe book aside and you already prepared the dish, and the recipe book has served its purpose. It tells you how to prepare the dish. Recipe book tells you what ingredients to acquire to prepare a certain dish, how to process them, how to prepare the food, all the instruction it contains. Once you have followed the instructions and prepared the food, then you don't keep the recipe book. You keep it in the shelf until it's needed next time. It's no longer needed. Same way, scriptures are like that. They have a certain purpose. Once that purpose is fulfilled, then you don't need the scriptures anymore. When scriptures tell us what is the goal of life. You have to know the goal of life. Scriptures tell us God realization is the goal of life, it tells. That we have to know. Once that is known, part is done. Second, more important part is scriptures tell us how to reach that goal of God realization. We follow the instructions given in the scriptures. Then we reach the goal of realization. Then you don't need scriptures anymore. Scriptures have a limited purpose, but there is definite purpose. They are definitely useful, but only up to a certain point, only until the goal is reached. In the Viveka Chudamani, there is one verse which says this very nicely, and even only Shankara can describe. The verse is, अविज्ञाते परे तत्त्वे शास्त्राधीतिस्तु निष्फला, विज्ञातेऽपि परे तत्त्वे शास्त्राधीतिस्तु निष्फला. सम ऑफ यू नो विवेक चूडामणि, यू आर स्टडीड ऑलमोस्ट यू आर एट द एंड ऑफ द बुक राइट नाउ, सो यू मे रिमेंबर और यू मे फाइंड इट इन द बुक. अविज्ञाते परे तत्त्वे, परतत्व मीन्स सुप्रीम रियालिटी, सुप्रीम ट्रूथ, ब्रह्मन, गॉड. Avijnate, if it is not known, then what good are the scriptures? They have not done anything. Shastra Adhiti is to Nishpala. Nishpala means fruitless. Adhiti means mastery. Shastra means scriptures. Simply knowing all the scriptures, being able to recite them and backwards and forwards with all the commentaries and everything, but not realizing God, what good is that one? Knowledge of scriptures of such a person is useless knowledge. It's only a burden. It only brings pride, but does not bring realization. But when the person has realized the ultimate truth, vijñāte pi pare tatve, paratattvam is supreme truth, God. Vijñāte, when that is known, God is experienced, then what is good is what is good are the scriptures. Shastra adhiti is nishphala. Nishphala means fruitless, useless. It becomes a burden. It has served its purpose, put it aside, and we remain established in God, realized in God consciousness. So that is the verse number 46. Vedas have useful, Veda means scriptures. In the Narada Bhakti Sutra, Narada says, everybody does not have to study Viveka Chodamani. Viveka Chodamani is a Advaita Vedanta book. Not everybody is interested in it, or it's not their part for everyone. For those who are interested, who are qualified, Viveka Chodamani is right. Jnana Marga is the right path. But Sri Ramakrishna says, for the majority of people in the Kali Yuga, Bhakti Marga is the more suitable path. The path of devotion, worshiping God as a God's child, as a God's servant, even think of God as a child also. Asilya Bhava, there is also possible. Following one of these bhavas, attitudes, we should realize God. Once it is done, we don't need the scriptures anymore. Scriptures only tell us what to do, how to reach the goal. That's verse number 46. Now we go to the most important part, one of the most important parts of the Bhagavad Gita, 2 verses 47 and 48. We only have a little bit time. We'll do 47 a little bit and begin it, and next time we'll complete. 47. You must have heard this verse so many times because it's often quoted. Most quoted verses, one of the most quoted verses, 47. Dear Bhagavan says, karmanyevadikaraste ma paleshu kadachana ma karma phala heturbhuh ma te sangostha karmani. I'll chant 48 also. Yogastha kuru karmani sangam tyaktva dhananjaya siddhya siddhya samo bhutva samatvam yoga uchyate. These two verses marked as 5-star verses. There are some 5-star verses in the Gita. These two are those, were some of those. Karmani yavate adhikaraha, your jurisdiction, authority only in regard to the karma you do. Phaleshu mate adhikaraha, in regard to the fruit of action you have no control. Work, I have the right. I can decide what to work, when to work, how much to work, which procedure to follow, what material to use, all those things, some of those things are in my control. But when it comes to the fruit of action, paleshu mate adhikara, you have no control. There's something hard for us to accept because we have the notion that we are the doers. I'm the doer, why should I not be able to dictate the outcome of my work? That question comes. Ma karma phale hetarbu, you are not the producer of the fruit of action. Akarmani te sangaha mastu, ma te sangostha karmani. Don't take recourse to inaction. We'll study this. This requires a lot of study and understanding and reflection. We'll do these two verses next time and continue. Now we have a couple of minutes. If anybody has questions on today's topic, today's verses, I'll be happy to answer.